Welcome to Leaders of Tomorrow, India's only daily television platform for small businesses. We bring you the right information to empower you, the SME entrepreneur. Tonight on the show, two interviews and conversations. First up, the influencer conversation is with 91 Springboard. On the other side of a short break, a small giant in focus tonight, EduSports. Reports suggest that by 2020, nearly 50% of the entire workforce is going to be comprised by millennials. Also, it's a well-known fact that India has one of the youngest populations across the world, and we have more and more people entering the workspace every month. Co-working then really is the solution to overcoming some of the infrastructure as well as logistical problems being faced by companies. I caught up with 91 Springboard to understand just that, the market opportunity for co-working spaces here in India, as well as their own plans this night. Varun, thanks very much for speaking with us here on Leaders of Tomorrow, and congratulations on this very beautiful co-working space. I want to talk about the fact that you are a serial entrepreneur. You've had multiple ventures before you set up 91 Springboard, and you've said that each of it has given you a different perspective on the way businesses are run and how things are done in businesses. So let's start by talking about your personal journey.
My journey started right after Goldman Sachs, which was my last professional job. After that, I took on five different startup opportunities, and today 91 Springboard is my sixth startup.
Okay.
The five were trainers and teachers for me. I learned many things. They would be called minor successes to failures, but they're great teachers for me.
Okay.
And they were in a number of fields from different areas, from a concierge business to an investment banking business to a media technology business to a travel business. I did a whole variety of businesses, learned a number of things. You know, how do you raise funding? How do you find your co-founders? How do you do digital marketing? How do you recruit people? I learned a number of these things. I sort of brought all of that together here at 91 Springboard.
Okay, so you're saying learnings, maybe one or two of the biggest learnings that you've had, because I want to use that for you to talk to our viewers to say that's perhaps been your biggest learning from your multiple ventures.
Of course. So none of them reached this stage that we are at today. So fortunately, unfortunately, I'm not able to apply many of those learnings now. Today I'm in uncharted territory. But some of the things that I applied early on, even at 91 Springboard, were things like, how do you find your co-founders? You know, who are those people that you're going to spend 18 hours a day with for probably 10, 20 years of your life, if not longer, right? I mean, they're your business marriage, right? They're your business partners, right? So how do you find those people with the complementary skill set and yet with the right chemistry, right? And that's something I learned early on going through these different startups, because I had to find co-founders there and work through that.
So you're saying uncharted territory, and I want to pick up on that and talk about the fact that 91 Springboard essentially has had the first mover advantage when it comes to the co-working space, and now you're present in multiple locations, you're looking at new locations, etc. But my question to you really is, we have now a lot of people who are coming into this space. You have a lot of peers now. So how perhaps are you now building on the fact that you've had that first mover advantage and using it to ensure that the future, as it's getting more competitive, you're able to maintain that lead?
So you're absolutely right in that there's a lot of folks that look and feel similar, right? Right from, if you go back to a couple of decades ago, there was a large company that all of us know that is continues to be around, is Regis, right? And they started the business center revolution. And then more recently, WeWork started the co-working revolution, right? And if you actually go back even before both of these guys, there was facilities management that was done by companies like JLL, CBRE. These are all different versions of creating and running and managing spaces, right? And that is only one aspect of what we do, right? So in an industry as large as this, in India, there's over 1 billion square feet of office space, right? And co-working is going to be a very large part of it. When it's such a large industry, you're going to have many varieties of services, right? And then there's going to be these mega working spaces that will focus on corporates. There'll be these smaller co-working spaces focusing on startups. There'll be women-only co-working spaces. There'll be co-working spaces which are maker spaces. There'll be this whole variety, right? So we've sort of picked a theme for us, which isn't focused on the infrastructure side of things. The infrastructure side of things we think is easier to put together and the barriers to entry are low. What we're really focused on, when we bring the startup, the SME, the freelancer, and the corporate all in the same building, how can we make magic happen? How can they collaborate so that they're personally happier, and so that they're professionally excelling, right? And that's what 91 Springboard's all about, bringing all of these folks together, using our team members to understand the needs of each one of these and helping fill those gaps.
Okay, so are you feeling the need for that gap? Because essentially you're co-working I'm talking from the perspective of an SME. SMEs are essentially looking for that space where they can have their employees positioned and it comes down to cost for them. A value-added service like yours, I'm assuming, would be priced higher. So for an SME who's watching this interview, maybe talk to us about that need and why you felt that that is a critical need that you need to fill.
Okay. So you brought two great points. One is our value over and above the infrastructure and our price, right? So I'll take your second question first, if you don't mind. I think we've understood well the Indian market. What's the best-selling car in India? It's a Maruti.
Yeah.
What's the best-selling phone in India? It's a Xiaomi. You know, it's not the Mercedes and it's not the iPhone, right? It's because
it's a price-sensitive market.
A value-conscious market, right? We want 80, 90% of the features of the best guy at 50% of the price. That's who we are, right? That's what we've grown up to be able to afford, right? That's where, in terms of economic development, our country is right now.
Sure.
Right? So we understand this well. We're all Indians, and we built our product in the same way. So to be honest, our product is actually very cost-effective, and any peer that you pick up, we're probably cheaper than that.
Let's also talk about the fact that, like you were saying, you're bringing together multiple people at the co-working space. And one of those, of course, is ensuring that you also have mentors, perhaps, who are available here to advise, to consult with the companies and the entrepreneurs who are based here, and the SMEs who are based here. What are perhaps one or two of the big things that you've heard from the mentors who are engaging with the people who are here in your co-working space in terms of what their biggest challenges are?
We spoke to our members, understood what are the areas of challenge, right? Sometimes it can be finance, sometimes it can be business development, sometimes it can be sales, sometimes it can be digital marketing. So we understood this. Then we reached out to a number of professionals who have 5, 10, 15, 20 years of experience in these fields, right? And many of them are willing to give their time pro bono to our members.
Okay.
So we organize these pro bono meets. Typically, we'll take the members' profile, post it on our networks, and our members, both within our spaces and outside, can request for that time.
Sure.
And we'll set up 3 to 4 back-to-back sessions of 40 minutes each with our mentors.
Sure.
And then we take feedback from the mentees as to how that session with the mentors was, and then we request the mentor back if those sessions were well regarded.
Interesting.
So
sure.
That's how we run our mentor programs.
Okay.
That's only one of our types of programs to add value to our members. Mm-hmm. Right? We've had investors come in. Like, reverse pitch is one of our most famous events.
Okay.
Reverse pitch is where a number of VCs and angel investors will come, and they will talk to startups, telling them why they invest, how they invest, which are their successful companies, what do their investors expect of them. They will explain all of this. Reverse pitch, right? Okay. The investor is pitching to the startup.
Sure.
Right? So there's a number of these where we've recognized that hiring, raising capital, many of these are pockets of gap that we can help our members with.
Okay. I want to talk also about funding. Have you raised funds? What's that process been like? Given that co-working is still fairly niche, it's not a very old industry in India, did you perhaps face any challenges when it came to raising funds?
I think we've been lucky over there.
Okay.
Right? We've received support from investors in Singapore, in India, in the Middle East, in the US. We've received now over $35 million of capital. We have ample capital to grow into the next year. One of the amazing things that I am happy to share today is that we are a profitable company. So all of the money we have is just to scale.
Sure.
We will sustain and we will survive even if we don't have capital.
Sure.
That's not the case.
Okay.
Luckily, we've received capital from a mix of investors. People who are professional investors and also people who are family offices.
Okay.
People who are repeat investors in us and people who brought their friends and family because they enjoyed the investment and the growth of their investment so much that they brought in further referrals.
Sure.
Our own employees have invested in our company.
Okay.
Our members have invested in our company. So it's a pretty amazing thing where we haven't relied on any large institutional investors exclusively. It's been this mix.
Sure.
So investments has been a very pleasant experience for us and privileged to receive support from so many people.
Of late, there have been a lot of conversations around why it is becoming more and more necessary and is becoming imperative that businesses and companies have internal complaints committees where employees can complain about any kind of harassment. My question to you is, as a co-working space, you have so many different companies which are based here. How do you ensure that processes are being followed? How do you ensure that you perhaps have a committee which is in place for complaints of this kind? And who's going to enforce those? Because, like I said, there are multiple companies here, so how are you enforcing that?
You're absolutely right. So it is a very important environmental reality today. And we play an important part because many companies rely on us to provide them a safe, inclusive, secure space to work. And we recognize we need to play a role there. It is, we are just at the point, I'll be honest, of recognizing that we can play an important role here. What is the best format that is legally permissible and yet effective for our members? We're actually researching as we speak.
My last question to you then, as I'm winding down this interview, you did speak about looking at newer locations and venues, but maybe something that's exciting you over the next couple of months, any plans that you can share with us?
Primary expansion plans right now are in the 8 metros. We're excited to have just launched Pune. That happened just a couple of weeks ago. And over the next few months, there is one new city that we should be launching in, which is Chennai. Right, so that should help us cover all the big metros, right? And so that's currently our focus. As I told you, research is ongoing in that tier two that is just under the surface. Expect big plans there next year. But this year, it's going to be a lot of demand in the major cities. And to be honest, we've only scratched the surface. The markets in these cities, if you look at all of co-working, is about 7 to 10 million square feet. We think demand here is in the triple digit millions, right?
Okay.
So there's massive demand, we've only scratched the surface.
I wish you all the very best for that, Varun.
Thanks
for taking
the
time today.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Let's take a quick break here on the show, but Bengaluru-based EduSports is a small giant tonight that's in focus on the other side. What are they doing as far as innovating in their own industry is concerned? More when we come back to stay tuned. It's well known that sports in India play second fiddle when it comes to academics, but one startup trying to ensure that they're bridging really the gap between academics and sports and helping the ecosystem, parents, teachers, as well as the students themselves really understand the importance of the intersection of the two is Bengaluru-based EduSports. Mansi Choksey caught up with the company to really understand how they're innovating and doing something different in the space. Take a look.
India has the second highest number of obese children in the world after China. According to a study conducted by the New England Journal of Medicine, India has about 14.4 million overweight children. Factors such as lack of outdoor activity and participation in sports are fueling such trends. EduSport, an organization that runs sports programs for schools, is determined to rekindle the love for outdoor games among children.
So much for talking to us, Saumil.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us something about your journey so far. How did you come up with the concept for EduSports?
So in our journey of trying to get children to play, we had looked at multiple business models. We started with after school grounds, then we looked at apartment complexes, we looked at raising sponsorship for inter-school tournaments, and we found that if we wanted to actually make an impact on getting kids to play at scale in a sustainable manner, the school as a center of gravity tends to solve a lot of the problems that exist in an off-school environment, namely aggregation of children, synchronization of children at the same time, and a model wherein you are able to charge a certain amount of money from parents at scale. And schools today are seem to be, unfortunately, given the urban context, the only sustainable and scalable way in which you can actually solve the problem of getting more kids to play. So after 6-7 years of trying different experiments, in 2008, we went down the school path and knocked on school doors. And to be fair, we had a slightly vague idea of what we would do. And over time, our school partner schools have also helped us fine-tune the whole idea of EduSports, which is including structured curriculum, assessment for each child, a trained trainer, parent involvement, parent app, reports for all stakeholders. The program has also evolved over the last now almost 10 years.
Tell us something about the different programs run by EduSports.
So EduSports, broadly, the whole larger vision is to make sports an integral part of education. Then the question is, how does that happen? The core program is the inclusive fundamental program where all children get exposed to the right fitness and the right skill at the right age.
Sure.
On top of that is the opportunity program where on weekends we conduct leagues where all the children in the school participate, making their own teams in the school context. We have an empowerment program where we focus on teaching self-defense for girls, which today, unfortunately, in the social context is a very important part, and we think it should be part of education. And we have a performance program which is about school teams and helping kids who are good in sports to achieve the next level.
Every school in India has designated time and teachers for sports. Then what is the need of outsourcing a sports program?
I think the fact that sports and physical activity should be part of education has been recognized by educationists over the generations. And therefore, there's a structure for physical education and sports in schools. As per the mandate, they're supposed to have an open space for kids to play. So clearly, we have recognized that children should play as an integral part of education. So the question was not design, the question was implementation. The question to ask is, what is actually happening in those 35 minutes when 35 kids come out to play? In most schools, what is happening is the PE teacher or the coach throws a ball at the kids and says, go play. Now, in that model, the kids who are good at sport play. The problem was not in the medium, the problem was in the way it was taught. So what EduSports does is to make sure that all children learn. So it's one, inclusive. Two, it is age appropriate, so that for a kindergarten child, the lesson plans and the equipment is appropriate for that age group. Inclusive, age appropriate, designed to fit into the school's timetable, constraints of limited time, limited space in most cases, such that all kids are covered. If it's part of education, all kids must get the experience of sport, not just the school team.
Sports programs run by EduSports help children build their stamina and prepare them for sports competitions outside of schools.
When before we were starting to play over PT periods or any gameplay after the school, we were just playing as a very casually. We are doing it like a time pass. But when EduSports came, we was morely like we are playing more seriously as we wanted to play for tournaments. As our gameplay improved, we started going to more tournaments, more exposure. Similarly, when you're going to play outside, we can see the changes that our fitness is increasing, our stamina is increasing.
So tell us something about the challenges you faced in order to convince the schools to adopt your programs.
So the first 100 schools, we knocked on, 90 threw us out, you know, saying sports is not important, maths is more important, parents don't care and so on. 10 of them, you know, said, interesting, tell us more. 3 of them said, where have you been all this while? I know my sports program is broken, but I just don't know what to do. So one big challenge has been access. That can we get access to the decision makers in a school context, the principal and trustees? And you know, shows like yours hopefully help us get access to more such people. That if you are really concerned about the quality of the sports program in your school, as measured by all kids playing, not as measured by how well my team is doing, then companies like us, like EduSports, are here to help. That's one part of the problem. The other reality was parents who acknowledged that the children are not playing as much as they should. Our 8th annual health and fitness survey shows that, you know, 1 out of 2 kids don't have the right BMI, 2 out of 3 kids don't have the right upper body strength, 1 out of 2 kids don't have the right lower body strength, 2 out of 3 don't have the right sprint capacity. So if you don't have these, kids will not enjoy the experience of play. So parents recognize that there is a problem in terms of fitness of children, and off school, the playground near our homes are disappearing. So however privileged you might be as a parent, your ability to provide an ongoing, consistent physical activity program for your child is severely constrained. So parents have not thought that the school is a potential solution.
Sure.
Parents have almost resigned themselves to the fact that, this is the way it is, and my children will struggle and they'll have to play in, you know, outside car parks and so on. but schools provide the facility. So the other part of the challenge has been to convince parents to demand more from the school sports program. So if you accept that sports are a part of education, you have to get take everybody along. And therefore, the way you train, the approach of the PE and the sports teacher, and the methodology by which they train, the structure that they have to engage all kids, the structure that they have to make the best use of available space and time, requires a certain support, which is what companies like us provide.
Tell us something about your revenue model.
So, the primary revenue model is essentially schools outsourcing their physical education and sports programs to us. Private schools form roughly 60-70% of our business. We also work with CSR partners who are looking to add sports as an element of improving education in the government schools or other underprivileged schools that they support. And we work with the government in two parts. One is as an NSDC partner, we run vocational courses from 9th standard onwards in physical activity and sports for around 350 odd schools. And we work with the Sports Authority of Gujarat in supporting the sports talent programs. So very broadly, private schools, government and CSR are the primary sources of revenue on the EduSports side.
Physical trainers are a crucial part of the programs run by EduSports. How do you acquire talented people for your programs who can manage children?
Yes, of course. I think what we have, EduSports Academy for Coaching Excellence, the focus is really on how do you deal with kids, especially those kids who are not naturally inclined to sport. How do you get them engaged in sport? The kids are already interested in sport, don't require as much pull because they're themselves pulling and asking you for more. We're lucky that there is a whole structural supply of Bachelor of Physical Education, Master of Physical Education and sports degrees that come out every year. So we do a lot of training in making sure that the people who join us understand first and foremost how to handle children well. Safety of children is a very big concern, has always been. We have a code of conduct that's signed up by the people who join us. We have logbooks that help us monitor the quality of programs. So we have a very structured EduSports certification program where we are also, as an NSDC partner, are able to certify people as per white belt and so on in terms of their actual learning what to do and actually implementing the program, which includes following the curriculum, assessing all children, reporting to all stakeholders, and making sure all children develop.
What are your plans for the future?
So as Sports Village, we want to get 100 million people to play and experience the magic of sport. As EduSports, we are right now at around 800 odd schools. We want to get to 2,000 schools quickly and get a million kids to play as part of the sports program and work with brands and leagues to help them leverage the power of sport for achieving their business objectives.
Thank you so much for talking to us.
Thank you for your time.
EduSports is partnering with private schools to raise the bar for sports education for children in India. The Indian sports education space that remains unexplored can offer a lot of opportunities to entrepreneurs.
All right, that's our show tonight. If you have any feedback for us or like either of these two companies want to be featured here on the show, do let us know what you are doing as far as innovating in your industry is concerned. Do get in touch at leadersoftomorrowtimesgroup.com, which is our email ID. You can also get in touch with us on social media. Tweet at me personally at Sunanda_J or LOT_ET now. You can also get in touch with us on our Facebook page, Leaders of Tomorrow on ET Now. Thanks for watching. Have yourselves a good night.